change me rage tomorrow. God, is at your side, no longer dread the fires of unexpected sorrow. God, you are my God, and I will trust in you and not be shaken. Lord of peace, renew a steadfast spirit within me to rest. Be moved by lesser lights and fleeting shadows. Hold onto his ways with shield of faith against temptation's flaming arrows. God, you are my God, and I will trust in you. Truth you learned in the beginning. Wait upon the Lord and hope will.
I hope you enjoyed that tribute to the United States Armed Forces. Wednesday is Veterans Day. And if you are a veteran of the United States Armed Forces, would you please stand? Let's give these gentlemen and ladies a round of applause. Thank you for serving, and we're going to pray not only for you, but all for all those who have taken your place over the years and who are now serving in the United States Armed Forces. We owe them far more than we could ever describe. November 15th, that's next Sunday, is Operation Christmas Child Retrieval Day of the shoeboxes. If you have one, be sure and bring it by next Sunday. In 2 weeks, on Saturday the 21st, is our next Remnant Cafe of serving the underserved at the Remnant Cafe. It's a great opportunity to be a blessing to those in our community who have great needs. And then 2 weeks from today is our Thanksgiving offering. Our offering this year, our goal is $60,000. And it will go towards $5,000 towards the Sarasota Medical Pregnancy Center. And the other $55,000 we're going to keep into in a silo fund to prepare for some days ahead. On December the 12th, it's a Saturday, the Ditchfield family will be presenting their Christmas program right here at our church. It is a ticket concert. So if you'd like to purchase the tickets, you can call the office and we can connect you with Bernice Ditchfield. It is a great concert. You don't want to miss it. Even if you've seen it before, it's always a little bit different every year. But this year is going to be more of a Christmas concert than the theatrical program downtown because of the limitations of the building. It'll be about an hour and a half program of straight, wonderful, encouraging Christmas music, and I hope you'll set that aside. Out in the lobby on the bulletin board out in the this side of the lobby, there are yellow cards that are hanging on hooks. Those are for our Saturday prayer team. If you have a prayer request, they meet here every Saturday and they pray over every single prayer request. Please write your prayer request on that card and put it on that nail, and they will pray for it at least 5 Saturdays in a row, and you can have your prayer request being prayed for. Also want to encourage you to join us every morning or during the day whenever you're available to watch the daily devotionals. They're about 3.5 to 4.5 minutes long. Terry informed me today that we've done 200 of them now. We started them right after COVID started, and it was going to be a little month or so project, and it's turned into 200 of those. It's to give us an idea of how we can meditate together and have the same devotional thought, and there might not be a more important time than now for us to have our thoughts centered on the Lord. Please keep Tommy Pomeroy in prayer. He's one of our new members. His father passed away this last week. If you please keep him in prayer. Brian, Rachel, and Lisa Williams, as they continue to deal with the struggles of Brian's health and a relocation. For Jason and Pam and Zoe Strom and then their adult daughters, Bridget, Brooke, and Brianna, Jason will be leaving this week to go to Birmingham to have an artificial valve put in, a mechanical valve, and this will be his fourth open-heart procedure. So if you please pray for Jason and Pam as they deal with the uncertainties of that. And then two things just to get it out there in the open. You know, a lot of things I'm concerned about the recent election, they are all outside of my control to address, but the two things that I think deserve the most prayer concern is the hint or the least circumstantial evidence that there was vast election corruption. If that's true, that's of greater concern to me than who won the election. But the most important to me is this idea of censorship that has arisen with Google, Facebook, and Twitter, in which these venues are now determining what citizens can share with each other, what the government can share with citizens, or what news outlets can even share with citizens. So Google, Facebook, and Twitter are determining what is misinformation. Now, even if they're right in all their choices, that's a very dangerous dynamic, because at some point in time, they're going to determine what you and I say about the gospel as being misinformation, and we've given them the power to eliminate that flow of information. To me, that is probably the most frightening development of this election process, was what has happened to Google, Twitter, and Facebook in terms of our ability to communicate. We have a lot of things to pray about, and I would say pray for the transition should it occur. Pray for the investigations into the election corruption. If it did exist, it needs to be exposed. But pray for the United States of America, that God will keep its hand on us and we can move through. But more importantly, that you and I can be the church of Jesus Christ, even if we feel a little out of place. Now, there may be many people here who voted for Biden and many people online who voted for Biden. That's not the point. Our culture is changing rapidly. We do not know where that's going to take us, but we know the Lord will be with us. So let's pray with faith. Let me ask you all, please stand together, and let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the men and women who serve in the United States Armed Forces. In seemingly countless wars and conflicts, often in forgotten places, they have risked their lives for those of us here back in the States to remain safe and secure. We do pray that their investment in our freedom will not be futile, that we will not surrender our rights for the promise of greater luxury or ease. Help us treasure the freedoms that our forefathers fought for. We ask you to bless our president and vice president and members of Congress, the president-elect and the vice president-elect, that you'll give them wisdom and insight as they plan out their transition. But Father, more importantly than anything, we ask for your superintending hand to lead over all those who are in authority and extend this window of freedom that we have and prosperity in our country so that our children and grandchildren can enjoy the America that we have. But more importantly than that, Father, we pray for the free exchange of the gospel, that we will be able to communicate it clearly, effectively, without hindrance. But should that day arise, help us to be faithful to you. We pray for our missionaries around the world that you'll bless them today and help them stay encouraged. May they preach the word of God with boldness. May you give them great fruitfulness. For Tommy Pomeroy, who is dealing with the loss of his father, may you comfort him. For Jason and Pam Strom and Zoe, who are dealing with the surgery that Jason will be having and how critical and risky it is and the long process of healing, that you'll comfort them. For those in our church family, like the Williams family, who are dealing with long-term illnesses, Brian and Josh Cole, and every single day is a struggle just to get through the next day, may you grant them power and strength and grace. And then for this morning, may we set aside every other concern and every other distraction, sing songs to you in an act of worship, and then open our hearts and minds to the truth of your word. For we ask that in Jesus' name, amen. Now please turn your attention to the praise team.
Please remain standing with us as we sing Cornerstone.
Lord of all, he is Lord. in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone.
Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
Christ alone.
Time, every voice.
Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Let them pray. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee. Swift and beautiful for Thee. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with
heaven's mercy seat. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is He. Sing a new song to Him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder, blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to You, the only wise King. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was Jesus, Your name is power, breath and living water, sent above this mystery. Yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation
Let's pray. Father, we thank You for this time. We thank You, Lord, through distractions and things, Lord, that we walk in with or walk out with, Lord, the things that are going on in our lives, the day-to-day, the grind, the mundane, God, the tough, the fun, all of that, Lord, that we can praise You and walk with You through all of it. So God, we thank You for the gift of life that You've given us. And God, we pray that it's a life that we don't waste for vanity, for accolades, Lord, but that we would give it to You. God, that we would find You of being worthy of our life, Lord. So God, we pray this morning that
in this moment, we would just calm our minds. We'd quiet them of the distractions in the day-to-day and everything that's going on, not only globally, nationally, Lord, but in our own personal life. The little things in our day, the little thoughts that we think, the things that are going on through our brains, that we would quiet those right now, Lord. And we would allow your word to fill up our mind, to permeate our thoughts, to, God, color our hours and our days and our weeks and our years, Lord, and that our hearts would be tuned to your grace. So, God, I pray during this time that you'd allow us to be attentive, Lord, to take mental notes or written notes, Lord, that will impact our lives from years to come, Lord, but that we would listen intently to your word and what you have for us. So we thank you for this time. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Boy, though, that last song and that music today reminded us how much our faith transcends every government, every leader, every nationality. Even when the Antichrist sits on his throne of the world, it will still be true that nothing can stand before God Almighty, and he sits on his throne. Open your Bibles to 2 Peter chapter 2. We're continuing our warnings from Peter about persecution, and then in the second epistle about false teachers, beginning in verse 1. But there were also false prophets among the people, even as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. Many will follow their destructive ways, because of whom the way of truth will be blasphemed. By covetousness, they will exploit you with deceptive words. For a long time, their judgment has not been idle, and their destruction does not slumber. We'll stop there. The first phrase is the phrase false prophets and false teachers. And it uses the same Greek word pseudo when it references teachers and prophets. And pseudo means fake. It means fraudulent. It means false, deceitful. So these false teachers and false prophets, they will speak fraudulent words, but their core fraudulence is in their hearts. And that's going to be an important distinction for us to keep in mind later. Teaching false doctrine is not the same as being a false teacher. A false teacher has a different motivation. False teaching can be the result simply of misinformed, well-intended, sincere believers who have been taught a certain way and continue to share it, but their intent is good, and they love the Lord, and they love the Bible, so they're not false teachers, even if they're teaching false doctrine. False teachers are at their core. They intend to deceive. So even when a false teacher is telling you truth, it's for the purpose of deceiving you. And here's how he describes them. They secretly bring in. So secretly, you know, it points to their true intent. They stealthily and surreptitiously add words to the teachings of the apostles. They bring new teaching, and it's for the purpose of subterfuge and sabotage. They secretly bring it in. Jude said they creep in unnoticed, and they're very good at it. As I was going over the message this morning, a memory from the 60s came back to me. How many of you watched Get Smart, the TV show? Well, it was really big in the 60s. A lot of iconic cultural phrases came from that TV show. Well, I have this vivid memory of one episode where Maxwell Smart is getting followed by chaos agents, and he senses something is wrong. So he turns around to see, and sure enough, there's two agents standing there in spy clothes with long trench coats and hats, and they freeze, they look at each other, and they run to go hide. And one hides behind a wire trash can that you can see through, and one simply stands up against the wall where Maxwell Smart can still see him. They were trying to creep in unnoticed. They were trying to follow Maxwell Smart, but they weren't any good at it. These false teachers, they are very good at sneaking in to the church. Unnoticed, they creep in with evil intentions. And what do they creep in with? Destructive heresies. And the Greek word for heresies sounds a lot like heresies. And what it means is a self-willed, a chosen opinion or position that is in opposition to truth. So the truths that they are bringing to the church, they have chosen these in opposition to the truth of the Word of God, and he describes them here as being destructive. So they're destructive to your faith. They're destructive to your walk with God. They quench and they grieve the Holy Spirit. And if you are unsaved, these false doctrines can obfuscate the gospel and keep you from ever hearing it. They're destructive. Here's what they do. They deny the Lord. And the word Lord there, most time in Greek, the word is kurios. In this passage, it's despotes. It's the word we get despot from. It's an interesting choice of word. They deny the despot. Now, in today's language, despot means a tyrannical authoritarian leader. But in the days of the Bible, a despot was simply a leader of supreme and absolute unquestioned authority. So Peter is emphasizing the complete sovereign authority of God, and he says false teachers deny that. So they deny the supreme authority of God, they deny his absolute authority, and they replace it with their own. And they sometimes shield that by saying, I'm replacing that with yours. They exalt man and the power that man has, but almost always to exalt themselves first. So they deny the despot, but despot not in our understanding, but in the ancient understanding, the supreme, absolute authority of God. Many will follow their destructive ways. And that word ways in Greek is just one word, asogeias, and it means licentiousness, sensuality, self-gratification, and indulgence. So these false teachers, whatever they're going to present to you, it is coming from a heart that is corrupted, and their ways are self-gratifying, licentious, and sensual. And many will follow their ways because they're telling you, you can live like I live. The way God has blessed me, you can have that same blessing. And then there's the tagline, usually, as long as you give to that particular ministry. What happens because of that? The truth will be blasphemed. So the credibility of the gospel is maligned. It is undermined because they make it say something it doesn't say. And all of that is not necessarily to get you to believe this. It's to keep you from seeing the truth. So it's a bait and switch. Even bringing up the name of Jesus and life and hope and peace and grace, all to get you to embrace these truths that will enrich them and prevent you from ever seeing the gospel. That sounds horrible. But that was in the early church. Peter is warning them, this is coming your way. They had very little power over their culture. They were facing very uncertain times. Not only was persecution coming, but sneaking into their churches was going to come a false gospel that was going to be so cleverly disguised they might not be able to even to discern it, unless they've done what Peter says, which is bury yourself in the Word of God. Here's what they will do, these false teachers. By covetousness, will exploit you. And it's two very vivid Greek words, pleonexia, and it means avarice, greed, and extortion. So by avarice, greed, and extortion, they will exploit you. So they want from you whatever you can provide for them. The next phrase, that word exploit, is imperousentai, and it means to traffic in, or trade in, or merchandise. So these false teachers, because of their own sense of avarice and greed and extortion, will use you, manipulate you, to enrich themselves by exploiting you, trafficking you, merchandising in you. And it takes a discerning eye to see where is that fine line crossed in the church of being a gospel-preaching church and to being a merchandising church. It's a fine line, and often we don't even discern when it's happened. But when it's done by a false teacher, it's done not to grow the church. It's done to grow an empire. It's grown to enrich the false teacher. How do they do it? With deceptive words. And the word for deceptive in Greek you're going to recognize, plastois. It's the word we get the word plastic from. These deceptive words, they're manufactured. They are artificial, but made to look real. But they are not as good. And they are designed to mislead. A few years ago, I was driving my father's Genesis, and the leather in the seat cracked. So I took it to Lexus to have it fixed, and they fixed it, and it looked perfect. But they didn't fix it with leather. They fixed it with pleather or something like that. And so in a matter of 3 weeks, the paint came off, and it split again. It looked great when they put it in there, but it didn't hold true. It wasn't strong enough. It didn't have the same quality, and it didn't stand up. That's plastois, plastique, manufactured. These false teachers will exploit you with manufactured truths. So then Peter says, for a long time their judgment has not been idle, and their destruction does not slumber. That's a sort of interesting phrasing. It's poetic, but what it means is it doesn't matter how long they prosper, how long they have power, how long they have influence, their judgment is certain and sure, and God will ensure that it is imposed. Judgment is not dormant. It is simply ready and waiting to be unleashed by God. Why does Peter bring that up? Why does Paul bring it up? Why does John bring it up? Why does Jesus bring that idea up? That judgment is coming. How severe will this judgment be? Well, look at verse 4 of 2 Peter chapter 2. For if God did not spare the angels who sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved for judgment, and did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah, one of 8 people, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood on the world of the ungodly, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them to destruction, making them an example to those who afterward would live ungodly, and delivered righteous Lot, who was oppressed by the filthy conduct of the wicked, for that righteous man dwelling among them tormented his righteous soul from day to day by seeing and hearing their lawless deeds. Then the Lord knows how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust under punishment for the day of judgment. Now, we keep in mind, Peter has yet to fully describe these false teachers. That's coming. And it's one of the most pictorial, graphic portrayals in Scripture. That's going to be next week. Here he's just warning them that they exist. And he equates the sin of false teachers with the sins of ancient times, which is a reminder of a truth that you've all heard, that Solomon said in Ecclesiastes, that which has been is what will be, that which is done is what will be done. There is nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which it may be said, see, this is new? It has already been in ancient times before us. There is no remembrance of former things. This is simply a recycling of the same sin of particular entities. False teachers in this passage are not just guilty of having and teaching wrong doctrine or theological positions, but also of having hearts that are just as corrupted as the rebellious pride of fallen angels, as the wicked disbelief of Noah's day, and the sexual deviance of Sodom and Gomorrah. So false teachers that are often respected and admired and prosper and are look so good on the outside, as Jesus said, are whited sepulchres full of dead men's bones, Peter equates them with demons, wicked people before the flood, and the sexual deviance of Sodom and Gomorrah. He wants them to know the false prophets are bad dudes and they're going to be punished severely. Now, in the Old Testament, the penalty for being a false prophet was death. In Deuteronomy, Moses writes, a prophet who presumes to speak in my name, God speaking, anything I have not commanded, or a prophet who speaks in the name of other gods, is to be put to death. That's how serious God takes it. In Proverbs 35 through 6, a warning to all of us. Every word of God is pure. He is a shield to those who put their trust in him. Do not add to his words, lest he rebuke you and you be found a liar. Jesus said, many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many. Many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. So he reminds his readers that God punishes the unjust. And he says it this way, God did not spare. Now that doesn't mean that God could have spared them because their offense wasn't that bad, but he didn't. It means he didn't hesitate to punish evil when the time was right. And he was very deliberate. In modern language, we would say he did it with impunity. And it's described as he cast them down. He brought in a flood. He turned the cities into ashes. He condemned them to destruction, and he made them an example. We don't like to ponder this, but God's wrathful punishment is dramatically and powerfully harsh. It's one of the foundations for why we should fear God. God is not playing the game that we often play. Christianity is a pastime. It's a recreation. It's a life enhancement. And we can sort of fudge on the rules when we want. That's not the way God approaches this. It was so serious to God, he slew his own son in a horrific, brutal death to salvage man from sin. He doesn't want his message played with. He wants us to communicate what he has said. So let's look at some of these characters. First of all, the angels who sinned. That's those who took part in Lucifer's rebellion. But it could have been also those in Genesis 6 who it's implied they had sex with women, evidently trying to corrupt the human genetic code. But the angels who defied God. He cast them down to hell. Tartarosas. Tartarus in Greek was an abyss that was lower than Hades. And it was where all the most evil, wicked people will go. Peter chose that word to say this is where God put the angels. It's akin to the word Gehenna that Jesus used in Matthew, which Gehenna was literally a 24-hour-a-day burning garbage dump outside Jerusalem that burned all day. The smoke never stopped rising. And that was what Jesus used to illustrate what this Tartarus hell would be like. Peter then says, and they are reserved in chains of darkness. And the word chains there really should be the word pits. They're reserved in pits of darkness. The pits and the chains represent being confined, being restrained, being locked away for a day of ultimate judgment. So God's reaction to these beings who fell was to cast them into Tartarus and to hold them in a bottomless pit. Jude, who is a half-brother of Jesus, described it this way. The angels who did not keep their proper domain, but left their own abode, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of that great day, as Sodom and Gomorrah, and the cities around them in similar manner to these, having given themselves over to sexual immorality and gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. That's awful harsh. But listen to what Jesus said in Matthew 13. Therefore, as the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of this age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and those who practice lawlessness, and will cast them into the furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. John describes it as the angel thrust his sickle into the earth and gathered the vine of the earth and threw it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. When Jesus told the story of the poor man outside of the rich man's house, Lazarus, he said the rich man died and was buried. Being in torments in Hades, he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. So those are horrible passages. Nobody wants to talk about them. Nobody wants to ponder them, consider them, but they're in the Bible, spoken by Jesus, spoken by Paul, spoken by Peter, and spoken by John. Which brings us back to that question. With such a horribly disturbing truth, why do these men, these prophets, and even our Lord and Savior, why do they stress it? Why is it in there? We don't want it in there. The idea of it is repulsive. So why is it there? I think it's for two main reasons, and this is just my speculation. Because it helps us not to envy the wicked who prosper and get to indulge all their desires because we know their end. And it will help us better understand the blessings of being recipients of God's grace because that is no longer our end. It's in there for a reason. Every believer should ponder what that means. David said in Psalm 37, "Do not fret because of evildoers, nor be envious of the workers of iniquity, for they shall soon be cut down like the grass and wither as the green herb." Solomon said, "Do not envy the oppressor and choose none of his ways." So Peter is writing to the early church who is about to be confronted by false teachers. And he's saying, don't assume that the success, prosperity, and power that you're going to see in these men are indications of God's blessings because their hearts are false. And the glory that false teachers have, it will be crushed by the wrath of God. For some reason, that was important for them to know. But then he adds, as God always does, that other side of it, and he reminds them that God delivers the godly. In each of those three acts of judgment, the angels, the flood, Sodom and Gomorrah, there was also an act of deliverance. When he chained and put in pits the fallen angels, he delivered the world from their future influence. They're still there, waiting to be arraigned for their sentencing. When he flooded the world, he delivered Noah's family from the corruption of that ancient disbelief. Where the Bible says, the thoughts and intents of man's heart was only evil continually. When he rained fire and brimstone on Sodom, he delivered Lot and his family. I was watching Fox News this week just to see what was going on in the world and as much as I could take it and try to find something else to watch. But there was a disturbing conversation among the five in this one program sitting on their benches. And these are all conservative people, and sometimes they've even been very vocal about Christianity in some of the episodes I've watched. But one of the hosts made a side comment about Jonah and the whale. Of course, it wasn't a whale, it was a large fish, but she said whale. And she said, when I was a little girl, I used to believe that. And they all burst out laughing. It's a ridiculous fairy tale to the world. But the Bible doesn't present it that way. The Bible presents it as an historical fact that brought about the repentance of a great city called Nineveh. That it was a miraculous act of God. That God cultivated and designed this enormous fish to swallow Jonah. But to the world, it's just a fairy tale. I remember thinking, here's five very, very smart, very professional, very pro-American, pro-Christian kind of people laughing at a Bible story. Well, some people laugh at Sodom and Gomorrah the same way. That didn't really happen. The flood didn't really happen. Angels, I don't know. It's all just for us to learn some life lesson. That's what false teaching does. It makes you question the credibility of the Word of God. He says about the godly, he can deliver us out of temptations. Pyrosmu is the Greek word, and it means to be put to proof. To provoke through adversity. So when God judges the wicked, he has no problem protecting the righteous from that judgment, nor bringing them out of testing. He can do either one easily. He can lead us through the test. He can protect us in his judgment. So there is no predicament in which God cannot sustain you and me. There is not any predicament from which God cannot deliver us. So how about eternal judgment? Are you and I free of eternal judgment? Paul writes in Romans, much more than having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. He writes to the Thessalonians, for God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him. I forget if it was Spurgeon or R.A. Torrey, but one of those great preachers used to say that they were so sure of their eternal standing with God that they could swing out over hell on a cornstalk and sing, "Blessed Assurance, Jesus is mine." That's what Peter is saying. God can deliver the godly out of temptation, both eternal judgment and the trials of life. He said to the Corinthians, no temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able, but with the temptation will also make the way of escape that you may be able to bear it. And the word temptation in that context is testing, not seduction, but testing. That when the world comes down on you, God will help you bear it. Then this great promise to the Thessalonians, the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And thus shall we always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Our destiny is secured. There is nothing that we can gain from following a false teacher. And this is why Peter is emphasizing this. This is why he emphasizes judgment, emphasizes hell, emphasizes God's wrath. And he tells them, but we will not suffer that. We will be delivered, so that they can keep in context the persuasive, dynamic, alluring words of the false prophet. Grounded believers do not allow getting more out of life or getting more from God to become the major focus of their hearts and minds, because that's the desire the false teacher will capitalize on. You want more out of life? Here's how you can get it. You want more from God? Here's how you can get it. Follow me, listen to me, and I'll show you the secrets. It begins with us having that desire to want more out of life and more from God. When that becomes your primary focus, you lose your perspective. Grounded believers focus on giving more of their time, talent, and treasures to God and serving others. So the question is, are we grounded? I asked myself that question this week as I was putting that together. Am I grounded enough to say that's me? I don't know. I'll know when the test comes. But I'm certainly warned, I better ground myself. I better ground myself in the values of the Word of God, the truths of the Word of God, because my destiny is secured. God has secured it. There's nothing I can gain from listening to, following, or implementing the teachings of a false teacher. Peter spends a great deal of time on this, and next week he's going to come around in a tirade against these false teachers so that his readers know what they're looking for, so they will have no regard for them, no compassion, no openness to their words, knowing that they're trying to sneak in and bring in destructive heresies. You know, we all want to be gracious. We all want to be kind. But you remember our kind and gracious Jesus? He kicked over the money-changing tables in the temple. He took a whip and he drove them out. He called some people vipers, snakes. He was mostly aimed at self-righteous Judaizers, legalists, who were robbing the grace of God and giving it to men to impart to others when you followed their way. Jesus had great anger towards them, but he still died to save them. He still offered himself a sacrifice, and whosoever will may come. We have a great Savior who has done everything required for you and I to be reconciled to God. We don't need someone else telling us more secrets, more truths that will make our lives richer and fuller and more enhanced. We need to follow the principles of the Word of God and follow our Savior. And Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. Take my yoke upon you, for my burden is light and my yoke is easy. He didn't say, come join the party. He didn't say, come have some fun. He didn't say, come taste the riches. What did he say? Lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where moth and rust don't corrupt. Let's have the perspective of the Lord as we go into this new age that's arising all around us, politically, socially, spiritually. Everything is changing. We need to keep our eyes on the goal, being faithful to the Lord, sharing the gospel, being salt and light to a culture that needs it, and being like Jesus in thought, word, and deed. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we do thank you that you inspired Peter to write such graphic descriptions, some of which we haven't looked at yet, but he was moved by you to communicate a warning, both about persecution and then this deadlier threat, which is false teachers that can literally imperil the soul. Father, we ask you to help us to have the discernment, the wisdom, the insight, the knowledge of Scripture to be able to recognize false teaching when we hear it, to have our own lives anchored in the gospel, that we will not give in to materialism and greed and avarice and licentiousness and make all kinds of excuses of why we can engage in certain things, and instead just embrace your authority. Prepare us for the days that are coming. Well, you've told us in your word that they're going to be so deceptive that if it were possible, even the elect would be deceived. Ground us in your word. Insulate us in your spirit. And give us wisdom, peace, grace, faith, and hope. And may each one of us be true to you to the end. Let me give you a moment to ponder the words of this message. If God said anything to you, you can speak to him right where you're seated or watching at home on live stream. In lieu of the missions minute this morning, I'd like for us to have prayer. I want you to join me in prayer for our nation. There are things outside of our knowledge and outside of our control taking place. Where they will end up, we do not know, but it's going to be a tumultuous couple of months. We don't want to get caught up in it. We don't want to be colored by it. We don't want to be corrupted by it. We don't want to have our faith shaken by it. Whatever your particular political belief might be, somebody's going to be extremely disappointed. We need to remind ourselves of who we really follow, the Lord Jesus. Even as we stand for cultural truths and principles, let's make sure we stand for the Lord Jesus Christ and face the challenge that believers in the Roman days, in the days of the Spanish Inquisition, in Russia and China, Cuba, Nazi Germany, Spain, France, England, people who stood for Jesus when it wasn't welcome. May we have that kind of purity. Join me in prayer for our nation. Our Heavenly Father, we do thank you that for centuries our nation has had the practice of the peaceful transition of power to a new leader elected by the people. And what a blessing it has been. We pray that that can occur again, but at the same time, you will shine your light on any falsehoods and corruption that needs to be exposed. But Father, we know all men are corrupt. Every government has corruption, and We don't know to what extent you would want to expose any of it, but we do pray for our nation that you'll give us peace, you'll give us prosperity, but mostly you'll give us a return to biblical values and virtues where we will respect the sanctity of human life. We will respect the rights of others, their ownership of property, their right to be safe and free, and that we might use that freedom to share the incredible message of the gospel of Jesus Christ to those who are still bound in sin. So, Father, we pray for you to intervene, for you to guide, for you to protect, for you to walk with us through this valley, wherever it may lead, and that you will keep your hand upon us, as you certainly have throughout our entire history, even when we've been in egregious sin. You've protected our country. You've helped us overcome the offenses and correct them. May you do so again. We lay our nation before you at your altar, and then ask you to use us to communicate a message of reconciliation, righteousness, truth, hope, peace, love, and freedom. And we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you, and thank each one of you for coming this morning. I hope you'll be back this Wednesday night. We'll have a Bible study here at 6:30, or you can watch on live stream. Next Sunday is the day to bring back your Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes, a great blessing to many children around the world, through which they will also receive the gospel. And then 2 weeks from today is our Thanksgiving offering. Please keep that in prayer for 2 weeks and see what God would lay upon your heart to give. Our goal is $60,000, and we are praying that God will help us achieve that. 2 weeks from yesterday is the next Remnant Cafe, and if you'd like to be part of that, you can call Cindy Hathaway, call the church office. We can connect you. It's a great opportunity to serve our community, and we hope you'll take part in that. Also, every Wednesday night, Awana's is right over there in that gym, and they minister to children while we're in here together. We hope you'll keep that in mind as you plan out your week. For all those watching on live stream, we hope you'll join us soon. We miss you. We look forward to seeing you. Let's all please stand together. We will be dismissed in a word of prayer, and I hope that you'll take the time to greet each other in whatever safe way you think is possible. Make sure you know that you love them, and just look around and see who's here, and just thank God there are people who want to still gather together. That's an important aspect of our faith. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your faithfulness to us, your presence in our lives, your goodness to us, your mercy, your patience and compassion, and your blessings. May each one of us this day leave encouraged and edified and excited about living for you in a culture that is often dark. You've made us the light. May we live like that. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful day, and we'll see you on Wednesday.